of humanity and suffering. He, in his human form, into the process. How many of us are called in here today that divinely submit to the process and the purpose that God has on your life? Or do you see a glimpse of the purpose on your life and then you fight it? You ask me, Minister Jeffrey, then why did Jesus cry out on the cross? Jesus crying out on the cross was referring to the beginning of Psalms 22. It's such the same way in our modern day church today that the pastor says, "The Lord is my shepherd," and you say, "I shall not want." Immediately your mind goes to this being the first verse in Psalm 23. So on the cross here, we see Jesus crying out, "My God, my God," and then you say, "Why hast thou forsaken me?" And then your mind immediately takes you back to, this is the first verse in Psalm 22. Psalm 22 was a prophecy in which David foretold 1,000 years before Jesus spoke these words on the cross. If you'll run with me really quick to Psalms 22, verse 7 says that Jesus will be mocked on the cross. If we jump over to Matthew 27 and 41, it says that he was indeed mocked on the cross. Jump down to Psalm 22 and 14. It says that Jesus' bones will be out of joint. If you jump over to John 19 and 36, it says no bones were broken on the cross. If you go down to Psalms 22 and 18, it says they will divide his clothes among him. Run back over here to Matthew 27 and 31. It says they in fact took his robe and his garments. Having suffered on the cross, Jesus cried out in the flesh, much like we do when we're going through something today and our human comprehension causes us to feel like God is not with us. Lord, where are me and not this? This moment was the very reason he had to take on humanity and sit down his immortality, his omnipresence, and his God. When have you sat down your will and your way and allowed the Lord to have his way in your life? Oftentimes, we're like the disciples. Jesus asked them to stay up and pray with him for an hour in the garden, and they fell asleep. Most of us have a friend or a relative that call and say, "Pray with me." You can't even get on your knees for 15 minutes and pray with your friend or your neighbor, let alone pray for an hour with the Father. We say, "Father, Father, use me." But most of us don't want to walk through the problem until the promise comes, let alone hang on the cross. This anointing cost Jesus something. It cost him some time and some separation from his Father. It cost him some agony, some suffering, and some pain. This is why we can still cry out that the blood still works. What happens when we go through something that might not be justified in our human minds, but when God is necessary? What do you do? What word do you stand on, and who do you call? Oftentimes when we're going through a storm, you feel like you're not hearing from God. You don't realize or recognize where he is. But can I suggest that we take a page out of the book of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? God didn't show up when they were captured and sentenced to go into the fiery furnace. He didn't show up when they were traveling that way. But none of us in the middle of the fire did God show up. We don't often realize that there's a purpose to our pain, and God will show up at the appointed time. Christ's flesh felt the world's sin, sorrow, and fear, but he stuck with the process. Though he slay me, yet will I trust him. God placed the presence. It was at this time that God made him, who had no sin, to become sin for us, so that we may become the righteousness of God. Jesus' words on that cross was an acknowledgement of these things, but yet another lesson or teaching from the Father. This time, Jesus is the subject of a parable, teaching us that both the vision tarry, wait for it, that if we suffer with him, we'll reign with him, that we can be taken in the face of our lion. In this last season, God is raising up a remnant of soldiers that won't look back. They won't break our pound town. They will suffer to reign, and they will bear the stripes in order to bring the harvest and set the captives free. Is there anybody in here today that needs to be set free? Will there be one in here today who's willing to suffer and walk through the problems until the promise comes? This remnant won't be afraid in the last days. They'll march into Marshall and take over the ground. Just as the kingdom of God suffered violence to violence, the remnant will take it by force. The flesh may buckle, but it won't break. We may cry out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? But the remnant will withstand the pressure with squeeze. We will walk through the problem until the promise comes. Is there one in here today? Is there one remnant in here today that's willing to walk through the problems and get to the promise that God has for your life? Learn how to love. Let's learn how to forgive. Let's walk through these problems and get to the promises that God has for our lives today. He came, he sent us here today for somebody to be set free. Because you're one in the number of the remnant today. Will there be one today who's willing to stand for God and walk through the problem until the promise comes?
Yeah.
God bless you.